So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Alisdair Meredith. I currently work at Bloomberg for John Lakos, who I'm sure many of you do know. For my sins in my past life, I was the C++ Library Working Group Chair for 5 years through most of the transition for C++ 14. So I've seen a bunch of this material coming through development. I started on the Standards Committee around about 2003, which was a really fortuitous time because that was the first meeting when extensions to C++ 98 were being considered. I just didn't realize I was there right at the start of the next big thing. We didn't realize it was going to take another decade to deliver either. But hopefully things are moving on a more even keel now and things tend to be moving quite a bit faster. So I hope you'll be happy with some of the things that we're seeing on C++ 17. And I'm just going to talk about how our interaction with tuples might have changed. It's more a refinement than a huge sea change in how tuples work, but it's been a nice incremental set of features and some new language features that make a fresh from the ground up implementation of tuple a bit more interesting. So my goals when I set out to write this session was to gain a strong understanding of variadic templates because they're all over tuples. And it's always nice to have a good worked example when you're trying to understand something. So I guess I'll look for a show of hands to see, am I teaching my grandmother to suck eggs? Is everyone here already intimately familiar with variadic templates? Yes. That was always a risk with this audience. So if you're widely familiar with variadic templates, you'll hopefully keep up with some of the new stuff that's happening from 17 fairly easily. You might find the material is fairly familiar. Sorry. Actually, implementing tuple will be our guide, but the other key thing was to try to take a look at how C++ 17 might change the way we approach this kind of domain of programming. What new language features have come in here, how the library has evolved in certain ways, and what features are there to help us now. So as I say, it was a take a step back into a ground-up approach to tuple. I'll take it then that my next slide is everyone already knows what a tuple is. Does anyone need a particular briefing in tuples? Okay, as I suspected. This is my notion of what a tuple is. It's a heterogeneous container because it contains a bunch of elements of different types. Each element will be accessed through the free function get. Supports the 6 logical comparison operators. Emulating a struct with n data members. Well, it's a little bit more than that. And it supports compile time reflection. You can actually query the type to find out what it contains, which is an important attribute. Here's a quick example of how we might go from thinking of regular classic C++ 98 to why we might want a tuple. So we start with a classic piece of data for someone who's working code for a specific application. And this is generally what you want to be working with rather than tuples when you're in a specific domain. But you also have the notion that you might be able to emphasize the structure rather than the contents by having a familiar naming scheme. And therefore, if we can query that naming scheme in the code, then we have the access as specifically written as code, we have the ability to do much more interesting things with this when we want to compose large generic pieces of software. So this was the basis of the C++ 11 tuple. One of the neat tricks we added in C++ 14 was rather than just getting by the numerical index, if you know you've got a heterogeneous container, it contains a bunch of different things, you can query by the contents and say, get me the integer, get me the string, get me whatever's in there. I see a hand.
What does it do when you have two integers? Does it
return
the first one?
So if I have two of a specific type that would match that query, the result is ambiguous and it will not compile.
Oh, okay.
Arbitrarily picking the first or the second didn't seem like a good idea, and it falls easily out of the programming model. The primary interface is still the index. This is a convenience where you know it will work. So again, does everyone know the answer to why get is not a member function? So the basic answer is that the syntax was really ugly when you started using it in generic code. Even though you weren't allowed to use it in non-generic code when C++ 03 came out, so it got really confusing trying to teach people who weren't familiar with templates. That's not this audience though, so. Quick brief history of tuple that, again, my audience will be familiar with. The earliest one I'm aware of was the Boost one. There were a wide variety of other implementations doing something similar, I would guess, but Boost was the popular open source one. And it generated all the code out of preprocessor magic, using macros to expand repeated, through repeated inclusion lots of code to basically build the struct with all the data members. And it gave you a fixed limit because in C++03 there were no variadic templates. You had to pick up front when you ran your preprocessor to generate, or wrote your preprocessor script to generate that file, that would be the maximum number of elements your tuples could handle. And generally they'd be also holding, if you wanted fewer elements, a bunch of default pretending to be not there types as well. So your tuples were larger than you would want them to be. C++11 specifically introduced variadic templates to solve the tuple problem, among a couple of others, but this was one of the key motivators. So in addition to the TR1 facilities, we now have variadic templates take away the principle of the upper limit. We'll come back to that a bit later. We added move support, which was one of the big features of C++11 in general. It's allocator aware, which surprises people when they think, I've got an aggregate, I've got data members in my type, where's the allocator being used? And the reason we have allocators in tuples is the things your tuple is holding might want an allocator. So when you construct the elements in the container, you want to be able to, in the tuple, you want to be able to give them the allocator at construction time that they're going to need. So it's just a pass-through rather than something that's consumed by the tuple itself. And an attempt to keep elements trivial if all the members are trivial. When I was doing my implementation for this talk, I failed to deliver on that guarantee, and I'm not sure I can find where I thought it was in the standard, so this early slide might be lying to us. So, changes or enhancements to the tuple API since C++11. So we've got the get type query function that was introduced in C++14. We now have widespread support for constexts, but all the way through tuple. And again, that was mostly added in C++14. The bit that makes me mad when I start looking at the C++17 implementation, and we're going to hear more about this later, is there was once we had brace initialization coming into the language, brace initialization gave a new meaning to explicit. And the constructors we had for tuple said, oh, I can make this thing might, this parameter pack might have one element or a million elements. So if I make it explicit for the case it happens to have one, it doesn't mean anything in all those other cases. But now it does. So now we try and spot when the explicit property needs to be retained. So our constructors are now conditionally explicit based upon the parameter pack that you instantiate the tuple with. And this generally means that if you thought tuple had too many constructors before, just double them. We have a new free function apply, which is a way to unpack a tuple and call a function or any other callable entity. To say, using this function pointer, call it with the arguments I find in this tuple. It was sitting around as an example in C++14, and someone filed a defect report saying, why isn't that example normative? And slightly ahead of where I'm going to talk about some of the other C++14 and 17 minor features, we've got this the new convenience of tuple size and tuple element, how you query how large a tuple is, what its elements are. We've got the new convention that we have alias templates with the underscore T that just means you don't need to do type name colon colon type everywhere. It just is a much nicer syntax to work with. And we now have a similar thing for where you query a value. We have an underscore V for a variable template. So that was my quick introduction. Probably doing fairly well on time still. Quick look at C++17 and where that's going to be taking us. I say the idea when I set out the talk was going to be much more of a C++17 talk than a tuple talk, and it's kind of morphed towards the end. One of the things we tried to do with C++17 is at least get our vocabulary right. There's too many confusing terms running around the standard, and some of these things other people were coming up with their own notions for, and the notion of a universal reference was popular for a while, and it didn't quite carry what the intent of the people advancing that idea were trying to say. So we now just simply have the notion of a forwarding reference, which means exactly what an R-value reference in a deduction context used to mean. We just now will always refer to that as a forwarding reference to try to get our vocabulary on the same page. So people would just know to recognize that doesn't mean an R value in this case. Because that does confuse a lot of people. This is actually doing the forwarding idiom instead. It's important to be able to distinguish that, and if you can't talk about it, it's very hard to teach it. Another wonderful piece of vocabulary we were trying to come up with was how to describe these things when I've now got a data member. I can actually have an initializer list to initialize it in the class, which says if I'm not initialized by the constructor, here's my default constructor this way. And we had a huge variety of names trying to describe these things. So again, just trying to simplify things, you know, get a common vocabulary, part of the C++ 17 schedule, because not many large features, but an awful lot of small features. The vocabulary is actually one of our features that we're trying to deliver. Something I'm trying to push through, it's in orange because nobody's bought it yet, is I just hate these function types that have funky volatile reference qualifiers on them, because they're not actually function types in the sense that they're not functions. You can't have one of these things and call it, but they exist in the type vocabulary and they exist as functions. So if any of your generic code says I handle function types, it's got to handle these abominable things as well, even though it can't use them, it can't form pointers to them, it can't form references to them. So yeah, I'm just hoping I can do something about that by the time we get to ship, but I'm not optimistic. New language features. I was expecting to be spending some time of this talk talking about concepts. There was a real hope that concepts were going to land in C++ 17. But it turned out that's not the case. We're going to have another iteration on the, or at least time to work with the concepts TS that has shipped only just within the last 3 to 6 months, probably 6 months now. We've not had time to absorb feedback and do anything useful with this on the standard committee yet. So it seems a little premature to start putting it straight into the standard when we put the TS out to get feedback. So if any of you are actually using the concepts TS that has actually shipped with GCC just a few weeks ago now, it'd be really good to get feedback from the actual customer experience of working with them. And hopefully they really should be a locked feature already for C++ 20. We're just going to tweak them as we get the next 2-3 years worth of experience. Fold expressions are probably the big thing in the world of variadic templates. I've got a fair few slides coming up about those coming up, so I'll not say too much now. Implicit comparison operators are something that haven't landed yet, but we're expecting to land them in the ULU meeting in a couple of months. About 8 weeks, actually. The idea here is that if I don't declare and define my operator equals operator less than, the compiler can synthesize them for me. And this is interesting when you're looking at something like a tuple, where the tuple's already got to do the same job. Will I be able to lean on this language feature instead and get the same effect? And if the effect is different, is that going to be confusing? So, heads up where we're going. Variable templates came in C++ 14. There's nothing super sexy and exciting about them. They're just a compact, nice syntax, so we'll see them being used quite freely throughout the code samples further on. And one of the things that landed at the last meeting, or maybe the meeting before, is some revised rules for the inheriting constructors syntax. So I don't actually have a slide on this, although I do use it to construct my tuple, so I'll say a bit about that now. The change is relatively simple, in that it simplifies the feature we had. In C++ 11, we introduced the idea of inheriting constructors. And I was on the hook for that paper, so you can blame me for the design that got standardized, which is we declare a whole bunch of implicitly declared and defined constructors that match the parameters that any of your base class you're using from would also have constructed. So we declare a whole bunch of new constructors in your class. And this turned out to have all sorts of really bizarre corner case problems when you started trying to deal with C-style variadic arguments. It was very hard to get those to work with this facility and stay ABI compatible. So, and a bunch of other small corners. So Richard Smith from Google, who's what compiler lead I think on Clang these days, came up with a simpler notion that simply says, I inherit the constructors. I have the constructors from the base class. If you construct me using a base class constructor, I construct the base class, and then I get essentially the same rules that were there for initializing all the other members anyway, which is, you know, they default construct, they use the value initializer that was there, which is what we were injecting into the constructors before. So this just means we're not declaring an extra mangled constructor as part of your ABI. So it should be simpler, it should lead to smaller, more efficient code. So it doesn't look very different to the user. It should be slightly nicer under the covers. Some minor template extensions. As I say, we introduced the variadic template, the variable templates in C++ 14. One of the ones that I'm stupidly happy about, even though it's not my proposal, is that I can finally drop using class in my source everywhere. The one place where class was mandatory was when I had a template parameter. I couldn't substitute struct or type name in that file place. It had to be class. And generally, I prefer to use struct rather than class when I'm writing code, because for me, it's got a preferable visibility, because I want to look at the user interface and then the private definition. I work with people who happen to have a different opinion, and I'm very happy coding that manner as well. But the slides you're going to see here tend to be of this idiom of using struct as the way to define classes. So yeah, that's just a nice little tweak. That 17 is a nice cleanup. And we also have the notion of constant evaluation for all non-type template arguments. And I keep meaning to go back and look and see what does that mean for floats. Or how we match const expert types. But it's a feature there. I should have, if I was talking more about this, I prepared a slide on it, but I didn't have time to do my due diligence on that one. Other concepts, template features that are expected to land in Ulu, as I say again, 6-8 weeks. They're not in this paper because I don't have the ability to work with them if no one's implemented them yet, but I expect these will all be in experimental compilers in the near future if they are adopted as we expect. The first one I know a bunch of people here will be really happy about is if const expert, which effectively allows me to have two compile time branches within a function where I can branch on some generic compile time parameter and say, okay, if this is true, I get one body of the code, one branch of the code expands, and I don't care if the code in the other branch would therefore be illegal. And this will mean we no longer have to go through all sorts of crazy nesting and forwarding techniques to try to make sure that every particular instantiation of our template is legal in all calls. We can just write much more simple, intentional code. So that's something I'm really looking forward to. I'm still not sold on the next one, but it's one of those simple convenience that folks about the application rather than the lower level library facilities will tend to like these kinds of features. It's just the ability to deduce use auto to say, figure out what my template type is when I instantiate the template. This is the annoying one where if I'm going to have something like standard array, I have to say what, is that? I've got the right one here. Integral constant, I'm thinking more. I've got to say, this is the type of the integer, and then here's the integer. Whereas I just want to give you one parameter. I'm repeating information. And this is a way to avoid repeating the information. But I don't see a way to get access to it for specialization, which is often something I want to do in these cases as well. So I'm not sure how much it's going to buy me. But as I say, we'll find these out when we have experience and play around with them. And there's certainly enthusiasm to move it fairly quickly into 17. The last template feature that would be very interesting for this talk if I'd had a chance to play with it, I've not had a chance to play with a compiler that does this yet, is the ability to deduce the template parameters from the constructor. So if you look at the pair here, I'm not saying what kind of pair it is. This would normally be where we would call make pair. This makes all those factory functions like make pair potentially redundant. So that's certainly something that has been wanted for a long time. And hopefully, we've now got the paper, we've got the wording that's on schedule to land again in the next 6 to 8 weeks. So fold expressions are probably the most interesting thing I have to talk about. Anyone who's familiar with functional programming will know much more about this than I do. I come from a C++ background, and everything I know about functional programming is what I've reverse engineered out of templates. So the name fold doesn't mean a whole lot to me, but I know it means an awful lot to people elsewhere. And the use of it just seems so obvious that, yes, this is clearly something we would be liking. It means that when we're doing a pack expansion now, we're no longer constrained by just having a comma-separated sequence of things. So here's the grammar for this straight out of the standard. Just to show we've got three different ways we can write a fold expression. We've got this funky cast expression, then the operator, which is any one of these things can now be used in the fold expression, and then we say pack expansion. Or we can do the pack expansion up front, the operator, here's the thing you're expanding over, or we can have a cast expression, an operator, a pack expansion, the same operator again, I believe, and then another cast expression. A couple of observations there. Exactly one cast expression contains an expanded parameter pack. So in that third case where we've got cast expression, fold operator, dot, 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 fold operator, cast expression, only one of those two cast expressions can contain a parameter pack that hasn't already been expanded. Conversely, one of them has to have such a pack as well. And likewise, the cast expressions above. It's a pack expansion context. So you have to have a pack to expand. If you've got two pack expressions, so I'm trying to assign A to B, where A is one from one pack and B is from another, I'm afraid we're out of luck. Expansions can expand only, fold expressions can expand only a single parameter pack. You don't have the parallel pack expansion facility that you have with the general use of pack expansion today. That's probably the biggest limitation.
Just to make sure that I understand, if I had open parens, x's plus y's, close parens, dot, 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 plus dot, dot, dot.
Mm-hmm.
That would not expand in lockstep both x's and y's and fold over.
Correct.
Why not?
I'm not the compiler guy who came. This was basically a feature that was proposed for the concept TS that was so obviously wanted by everyone else that they just landed it straight into C++ 17. I'm not sure how many of the issues came up as part of trying to do concept reasoning in a lot of these cases where you're trying to do subsumption as you're passing through these pack expansions. But there were certainly a few other issues that the compiler folks said, this part's hairy. We don't want to standardize it until we've at least, tried to figure out what the hairs are. Whereas what we have here is very easily implementable. Or I say very easily, it's in Clang, it's in GCC. So at least two compilers are shipping today where you can use this already. So. And the other one that keeps catching me out every time I sit around just trying to put a bit of playful code with this is the parens are actually a necessary part of the grammar and you can't omit them. Keeps catching me out. I don't know how many times I'm going to have to learn this lesson. So if you sit down and you've not used these before and you're trying them out and you're getting some strange compiler messages and you're just trying to put the parens in and 9 times out of 10 that's what you've missed.
Have to have the parens. You can't expand this in a brace initializer, for instance, because that's also an expansion context.
But you don't lose the old ability to do an expansion within a brace list. But why are you trying to execute a fold expression within a brace list that you can't parenthesize?
Fine.
Could you repeat the question for now?
Sorry, I've just been reminded that I need to do a better job of repeating the question. So the question in this case was, why do we need the parens? If I'm trying to do something like expansion within a brace list, why do I need to put an extra set of parens in there? Again, I'm not the compiler guy, just because, as far as I'm concerned at the moment, that's what the grammar says. I'm not sure what potential ambiguities it's saving us from. The ellipsis is... So we've got pretty much every operator. I've not gone through the list to see what isn't overloaded in there. Clearly not the ternary, new, delete. But most of the symbolic operators, I think, are all overloadable, are all foldable. Cast expression sounds like a funny thing until you realize that contains consists of a unary expression or a cast of a unary expression. And that pretty much is every kind of expression you would use in a language. So it's a very, very flexible thing. It's not limited to cast like it looks like if you just read the words on the screen.
Did you say something?
something about the double ampersand and double vertical bar operators there and what they do?
Could I say something about the double ampersand and the double vertical bar operator? I will later on in the session. We're going to see code examples with those throughout the tuple implementation. But we will have a simple example of a fold, just to see how this looks, what this looks like in code today. So I've got a simple sync function, just so I can swallow arbitrarily anything. I'm using the make index sequence to just create a large compile time pack of 2048 numbers 0 through to 2047 as integer parameters to an empty struct. I call my test function and I pass it the index sequence. So I now, because this is the idiom of using index sequence, I have a variadic pack of indices that this now actually makes me something that will match that. So the test function gets to deal with the unexpanded pack. This was a really, it's a fun trick the first time you discover it. It's incredibly useful once you know it. And it's completely opaque until you've figured it out. So before I jump on too far, is everyone familiar with this index sequence idiom, or do I need to spend a little bit more time talking about it? This is probably the best time to talk about it if you want me to. Okay. So make index sequence this is an alias template that is an alias to a type that is basically called integer sequence, which is parameterized on an integer type. Size t by default for index, and there is back integral constant, but rather than having a single constant, it's got, in this case, 2048 constants after the thing that says I'm of using type size t. The struct itself is empty, just like an integral constant. But I now have a type that, as part of its type name, as far as the grammar is concerned, includes integer or size t, and then the numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, all the way up to 2048. So when I call test, I can parameterize test on a parameter pack of indices, and I pass it an index sequence, which is just a regular object where I generated a single number. And it turns that number here into the full pack when I delegate to the next function down. So there's always a level of delegation involved when you're using this idiom, but it now lets me generate packs of digits that I might frequently want to use when I'm trying to index things in tuples. It's a great way to unpack and say get of my index. So if I want to pass all my elements through by getting them, I probably want to have an index sequence somewhere running around that will let me do the indexing. So I'm now creating a standard array from that sequence. Initializing index, an array size of the index. And I do this because standard array has get defined on it. It's an empty array, all the values are going to be zero. I've got an array of 2048 zeros. But it gives me the ability to now have a fold expression where I'm doing an ellipsis, the comma operator. So this is fairly similar to just a regular pack expansion like we'd have had before, but I've got to put these parentheses around. I spent way too long looking at this example thinking, without these parentheses, why doesn't it compile? It's because the parentheses are in the grammar. So it's going to generate me a sequence of 2048 sync calls, which will all printf0, each separated by a comma operator. So that is one huge comma expression of 2048 sub-expressions, written fairly compactly. So what happens when I compile this? Clearly the program's not going to do anything very interesting. I was interested when I looked at the results of building it on Clang and GCC, though. When I built by default, which I'm not sure if that's 00 or 02 these days, just built C++17, this C++ file, GCC 6.1 was 2 seconds, Clang 3.9, 1.7 seconds. Roughly similar speed on the machine I was dealing with. And then I thought, oops, I forgot to ask for warnings. I turned wall on. GCC is showing that this feature might not yet be fully baked. It works. It does. I've not found any bugs as such. But the compile time performance when you turn warnings on might be surprising. Clang said, yeah, warnings, of course. That's what we do. And then when I turned on the optimizer, I didn't turn on more when these, you can see that GCC is actually slightly faster when I build in the optimized build mode, whereas Clang is doing something interesting in its optimizer in O3 mode, and that's now the slower one. If I do O3 and wall, though, we know where we're back to. The image size was also very interesting. As I said, the default and wall are both the same. They're basically full debug as far as I can tell. Clang strips this thing down fairly reasonably to about 88K, which is a lot of printf statements. Each printf is its own sync function, its own instantiation. So GCC is clearly doing something much more interesting, probably keeping hold of all of them in different ways. I was quite surprised to see there was almost an order of magnitude difference in the image size of these. That's in a debug build. When you go to a release build, Clang's still doing a better job, but you can see an awful lot of the GCC overhead was the fact that it's holding a lot more information about these folds in a debug build. So your experience of using these with different compilers, although you should be getting portable results, there's interesting points in the space about how well these things are going to be. Oh, well, we'll wait for them to mature. I filed a bug report about the 30-second build time, by the way.
So could you go back a slide?
Back a slide again? Yeah.
Guaranteed to be sequenced. So basically, is there a sequence point at every of the expanded?
In this case, yes. There. So the question is there a sequence point between each of these comma operations? And in this case, yes, there is, because sync returns void, and the comma operator on two void expressions is a sequencing operator. If, on the other hand, these were expanding to types that actually had a user-defined comma operator, you would lose the sequencing at that point, as those then become function calls on those user-defined comma operators, and there's no sequencing on the initialization of those parameters.
Oh, all right.
So it's the comma operator that we're familiar with today. So the other interesting feature coming from C++7, two questions at the back. Not run so fast. Sorry, can you put a semicolon here? No, this has to be an operator. The semicolon is not an operator. And specifically, it's not a fold operator. It's got to be one of those operators. Another question. Does it enforce the order if you put braces around them? What it will do is, if you put braces, the only meaningful place you can put braces is around this whole sync expression. Because I've got do a fold of this operator on this expression. I can use parentheses to order whatever's happening in these expressions, but not how they're going to order into the fold. Was that clear? Okay. Hopefully we'll see some more examples where I'm doing slightly more interesting things in the folds that might give you the intuition as well. Any other questions before I move on? Okay. Implicit comparison operators. Given they're coming, I thought I ought to have a slide or two about them because I looked to see how would they work with tuple. And the immediate answer is they have a slightly different semantic that in 99.3% of cases you will not notice, I suspect. If your type does the obvious things for the six operators, and then you aggregate them into tuples, they're going to behave in a sensible manner because you designed a sensible type. If you start doing more interesting things with your ordering, so maybe you don't have a total ordering of your type, so less than's not symmetric and so forth, you might start running into some of the corner cases because we have a different rule for determining the exact semantics of equality or more specifically operator less than. But the basis of the idiom is what I think David van der Voorde and Nico Yusutis in their templates book called the Barton-Nachman trick. I think I got this one right. Well, the idea is, even if I've got a template, if I declare and define inline inside that class template a friend function, I get an ordinary function. It's not a function template, although its function parameters are template types. So it's a function whose type I could not define outside of the class template, because in order to try to declare it, I would have to make it a template. As a friend function, it's genuinely an ordinary function. It's just got funny template parameters for its type names. Much less interesting in the regular case, but very much specifically, this is how you make sure in overload resolution, for instance, you've got the rules that I am now an ordinary function type and not a function template when it comes to partial ordering and all those other rules. And likewise, you want it to be a friend because it's going to have intimate access to your data members if it's going to try and give you the implicit ordering. So we'll start with equal equals because it's the simplest one. We do a member-wise equal equals in order, and the first element that says false, we return false. If we get to the end, we return true. Equal equals is simple. Operator less than starts by doing member-wise equality, which is interesting. But if we said let's do an aggregation, I'll do less than on the first and less than on the second, well, it means I do less than on the first and that's my answer. It doesn't mean anything. And we could potentially do the evaluation in both orders to see is the kind, is this one of those funny types that doesn't have an absolute, well-defined ordering for everything, is kind of these equivalent values. But that's probably not what you're asking here. What you'll say is these two values order when whichever of the first of the elements that doesn't compare equal says that's the part that's different and I'm now ordering on. So I go down each element in turn till I find one that doesn't compare equal, and then I say this is the part that's interesting, now I'll do the operator less than and return that. If I get all the way to the last element, rather than doing operator equal equal in the very last element, I will immediately go and call operator less than. So operator less than or equal to is exactly the same, apart from the fact on that very last member, we will do the equal equal first. Question?
Do you know why it's not defined the same as lexicographical compare?
I wasn't involved in the evolution working group. Sorry, question is there a reason this wasn't defined the same as lexicographical compare? It was certainly considered. There were an awful lot of things considered. I wasn't in the evolution working group that weighed all the merits of these and picked the final answer. There was a real desire to say, let's not be weighed down by the baggage of our existing code. Let's do this right and figure out what we think right means. And then we can see if we can bring the rest, if that works, can we bring the rest of the world forward to have this reasonably consistent, useful semantic. And it seems to be the right thing in the majority of cases. And you want your default to be the one that's most frequently useful. Doing the lexicographical compare, for example, would be twice as expensive as for each less than I have to compare both ways to find out if I go to the next element.
Two-part question. The first one is, what happens if you have a raw pointer as a data
member? In that case, we try and invoke these operators and go, oh, that's... The question is, what happens if we have a raw pointer as a data member? And yes, we try and use the operator, and that's not well-defined behavior. And I believe that would therefore suppress the implicit generation. We've not yet got the final wording in front of us. It has certainly been mooted that the implicit should not happen for a variety of cases. I can't do the comparison, or I've got a pointer because pointers routinely don't compare. I need much more specific information to know that I've got two pointers into the same object.
You answered my second question. That's good. Okay. Are these declared const expert if the underlying comparisons are const expert?
That's a good question. Are these declared const expert if all the underlying operations are also const expert? And you could probably say the same thing about the exception specification. I would have to go back and check the final wording. I believe const expert should follow. I'm not sure about the exception specification. But to close the loop, we've got the greater than operator is synthesized by just reversing the arguments and following the same rules that you would for operator less than. And likewise, less than, greater than or equal to does the same thing. And not equal clearly just negates the result of equal equal. Any other questions about what this feature looks like? Question at the back.
So if you use this for tuple, will you be able to override it?
So if I were to use this for tuple, would I be able to override it? I'm trying to figure out the best way to answer that question. On the face of it, I can't use this for tuple because the semantic is not what the standard specification says for tuple, as my next slide says. If these things are being implicitly generated and I don't want the implicit behavior, I can always provide something that will be found instead. Strong matches. And before synthesizing them, it looks to see, could I find a match that would allow me to evaluate this operation already? So I don't go hiding good functions that are already out there. There's probably a bit more subtlety to that rule that I would need to sit down and study, because this isn't to talk about this specific operator. It's just a quick introduction to it. But it's a good question. It's an important thing to understand before we start using these in anger. Will you be able to effectively default and delete them like you can with a constructor or an assignment operator? And no. There were many suggestions to do this. There's a feeling that we easily decorate our code with too much paraphernalia. And the more implicit something like this can be when we're trying to make it just a default behavior of the language, the better. Conversely, we discovered a need to invent default and delete when we tried doing that with constructors. So whether that's going to come back again, the language is always moving forward.
Is the parameter typed for these functions by value or by reference to const?
Good question. The parameter type for the question is, what is the parameter type for the synthesized or deduced implicit functions? Is it const reference or by value or by some other mechanism or perfect forwarding? We wouldn't get perfect forwarding because it's not a template. I believe the intent is const reference. But again, I'm not authoritative. I'm just quoting off dim memory.
I seem to remember that there was something involving like avoiding slicing that was attached to this paper.
Yes, there was a big rabbit hole I was trying not to go down. So I'm not going to go down that rabbit hole. I will repeat the question that we vaguely recall there were some rules in here involving slicing. And the essence of that discussion is, I'm trying to think, I can't remember what a specific problem slicing was deemed to be causing. Potentially as to whether it's trying to synthesize these members or not.
But it was certainly
seen to be the window we could then jump through and take slicing out of the language. So if the paper proposing this is accepted, slicing by value objects to their bases will be ill-formed in C++ 17. And that's a big deal. Now, in order to minimize the amount of code that would break, and specifically to support using these things in a lot of places where we want to use them, which is where often types have been using tag dispatch, you've got a lot of empty types or types that they're a mixin, they don't add anything, they just derive and don't add any new data members. So as long as no new data members are being added, the slicing rules of old will still apply. Otherwise, you will have to explicitly cast. And that, I believe, is still going forward in the paper as proposed.
So,
you're saying in the general case, slicing is going to be ill.
Slicing by value. You could always bind to a reference to your base, but you can't construct your an object of your. So, and it was deemed this is far more likely to fix more bugs than intentional use that would. Where it was intended, and the intentional use would definitely be more clear if it was explicit rather than implicit today. So, but as I say, that wasn't part of the discussion in the with respect to tuple. I'll take one last question, then I'm going to move on.
Can you make the address of these functions?
I have no idea. The question is, can you take the address of these functions? I'd be surprised if you couldn't. I wouldn't be surprised if the syntax to trick the compiler into doing it was also obscure. And use lots of auto. Static assert, when I was looking at a much broader 17 talk than a tuple focused one, I'll just let the slide in because it's quick and easy. When you have a static assert today, you have to provide the descriptive string to say this is what this assertion is warning you about. Sometimes the expression that you asserted on is good enough, especially when you're using good, meaningful names and traits and things in your code. So it's annoying to try to keep coming up with all these different string literals just to describe the expression that was fairly clear. So in C++ 17, static assert, you can just give it an expression, and kind of like regular C assert, if you don't give it a string, in this case, it will just say, well, I will stringize your expression, and that becomes as if that were the string you supplied. So quick convenience. New library features that are relevant to a bunch of this stuff working in tuple. The key ones were integer sequence, we've already had a look at. Variable templates don't, I think, add significant new capability. They just make the code a little bit more compact and easy to write. We've also got three new type traits, conjunction, disjunction, and negation. These were basically coming out of the GCC standard library, and I'm sure a fair few others, where they were spelled and underscore, or underscore, and not underscore. And there's a whole bunch of people, myself included, get really freaked out when we see identifiers with a trailing underscore because it's not joining to something. And that was a big discussion because lots of people are really happy with this idiom, but those who don't like it really don't like it. So we ended up with slightly longer names for these frequently used types. What these produce is basically a pack expansion. It's not a pack, not even a pack expansion, it's a recursive expansion of that operator on a type trait to produce the net, it's kind of like, and, or, and not for integral constant in type traits. But what you end up with is the appropriate integral constant trait, or actually the type that comes out of the things we're doing the expression on. Because I don't have any real slides on these, I thought they were going to be more useful to my presentation than they turned out to be. I'm waffling because I delegated this to a slide I never wrote. My bad. The key benefit of these, though, compared to fold expressions, which also solve frequently the same problem, is these have lazy evaluation. Anyone who's written lots of template code will know what I'm talking about, and that's probably at least half this room, but probably not all of it. With the benefit of lazy evaluation is, I don't have to instantiate every part of, say, a pack expansion and make sure every single one of those instantiations was legal code before I start evaluating operations that could short circuit. Which means that if, through these traits, if I've got a requirement that some type is convertible to something else before I can do the next operation, if I fail that first test, as part of my conjunction expression, I'm never going to get down to do the next test that wouldn't be valid code because I don't have the operation I need because I failed the first one and it short circuits out. So it's a really useful property. But turned out I didn't make much use of it in my tuple implementation. I know that the Clang and GCC ones make much more heavy use of this. C++ 17 type traits. So this is just the new traits that are coming through. We've got all the underscore V variable templates that are the analog to the underscore T type traits aliases that went through in C++ 14. bool constant is now a simpler way to spell integral constant bool. Little things that make a surprising difference when you start using them. So we've got the predicate logic type traits I just described. Is swappable and is no throw swappable now become traits in their own right. This is vital to anyone who's actually trying to constrain their swap operators and give them a not constrain them, but give them a no except that involves is an ADL swap on these operations going to throw or not. I can't write that in a no except expression myself, whereas a standard library can do it if it gives you these, exposes these as traits. So this is going to be really handy for folks who want to write their no except or catch their no except swap operations. Is callable is the missing invoke related trait to say, is this thing callable with this bunch of stuff? Definitely useful when you're writing a lot of generic framework type code. Is contiguous layout is really vital to those folks who are doing a lot of the embedded work to say, this type consumes all the bits in its footprint. There are no padding bits, no padding bytes. And therefore, I can therefore do memory comparison of these things and know that I've got a good order, you know, a good comparison, and I'm not comparing random junk bits in the middle. And that enables certain kinds of optimizations. And new transformation trait alias void T. That's worth a talk in its own right, the way that enables all sorts of interesting metaprogramming. For the classic inspiration behind it was this allows you to actually codify in your library, essentially, the has member X type trait. There's usually some variation on void T now, rather than trying to write your own version of that trait for every single member type def you ever want to detect. Really handy. That one came from Walter Brown, who seems to be very good at these little handy tricks that just solve so many problems. Extensions on parent tuple. Anything in purple is things that we don't have yet, because those were on the slides I was talking about earlier. This is something we might get in 14. So index tuple by type we've already mentioned. Constructors are conditionally explicit, I mentioned earlier. The apply function. This is kind of how you would use it to say, I want to apply this function or functor or anything that's callable that can be called with these three arguments. And I'm using this funky tuple syntax just because it looks easy on the page. We don't actually have that yet. But that was an assumption we got the deducing from constructors. And another function we're looking at is make from tuple that will do the converse to say I've got arguments in a tuple and I want to construct something of type T. So Y here will be of type T. They'll be constructed by unpacking those tuples into it. Those arguments of that tuple into it. Question?
Does apply return the result of calling the function?
Yes, it does. It's might even be a decal type auto of doing the evaluation. Otherwise, it's some even cleverer template metaprogramming to get the right result, but I think it's relatively simple with the 14 editions. Okay. So that's about halfway through my time. It's probably about a good time to be here. I'm now going to try and implement tuple or most of tuple before the end of the session. My goal was to produce the simplest implementation of tuple I could using the new language and the idioms available to it. And there are various definitions of simple. I was looking at fewest expressions, essentially. So it's compact code, but by being compact, it's not necessarily what other people might think of as being simple. So some of these slides could be dense. So we'll step back to go to the basic idea of designing a tuple. I came up with six potential implementation strategies. The classic early one was a recursive tuple, where a tuple is a tuple of a tuple of a tuple of a tuple until eventually I have a tuple of a single element at the end of the recursion. The technique that became popular in C++ 11 is multiple inheritance. I have a pack expansion of base classes, and each base class holds one of my members. Another one I was looking at was storing elements in just a well-aligned char array, raw memory. So I've got an array of the right size, and I can do compile-time computation and know where to slice into there to find the appropriate alignment and size for where an object should be constructed. Another one that was mentioned to me was you might be able to do this by storing the elements of the tuple in captures of lambda expressions and then pull them out of there. So another notion I came up with would be adaptive according to the parameters. Once I've profiled all these different approaches and found out when they're useful and when they're not. When I was looking at implementing variant as part of the C++ 17 library going forward, I made sure I had an implementation of that to play around with for a while, or at least the parts that concerned me. I found that different approaches to variant gave very different properties when I had large or small variants, as in large number of potential elements. Some had huge overhead one way, and some were, when they were small enough, lots of inlining could actually take away the overhead completely. So I wanted to switch between different strategies round about a size of 16. So would the same happen in tuple? And the ultimate, of course, would be your tuple to be a compiler intrinsic. This has always been suggested since tuple was proposed for C++ 11. Sadly, is that the right way? I said, Okay, I thought I'd got my next, when I went through my approach of which ones I picked. We're gonna come back to that shortly. That's what I get for not having given my talk before. I'm slides ahead of myself. Standard constraints required by the standard. I'm not convinced by that first one anymore. I'm going to have to go back and do my homework on that. I started doubting it a lot more as I was preparing the slides through the end of today. But if I've got a tuple event, should that tuple be trivial? I don't think it actually, by the rules of tuple, is allowed to be anymore. I think we tried to intimate it should be by defaulting a bunch of operations, but I don't actually think maybe those operations can still be trivial, in which case my implementation is non-conforming. I'll have to go back and try again. It'll be a literal type if all the members are literal types, or more specifically, your operations will be const expert if the operations, all the underlying type supports them being const expert, including all the constructors, other than those constructors that take allocators. It's been argued that there's a requirement that we compress the storage of empty class members, that this falls out of some ABI requirements that are backhanded and squeezed through. I've never quite found the wording that was in there. Howard Hinn assured me it was in there when this was coming together about 2011, 2012. I've not nailed him down to see if he still holds to that. He certainly thinks that's how this always should be implemented, and I don't think there's much dispute on that. And initializable members, slow my mouth down again. Okay, so the constraints are from the constructors we have. I can either initialize all the members or I can default them all. But unlike an aggregate, if we think of tuple as modeling an aggregate, if I've got an aggregate of seven different members, I might provide the initializer list with brace initialization for the first four, and the last three get brace initialized. It's a nice property, but we don't get that with tuple. Which is also a liberating thing when you're trying to implement it, because it's a pain to try to emulate. Although I believe the Clang implementation does so. Because Howard Hinton was trying to propose that as an extension for the standard for quite a long time. I think we might have finally crammed enough other things into tuple that might no longer be viable. But it's still an area of active research. Then we get the quality of implementation questions that might guide what kind of implementation do we want to produce could guide the strategy we choose to implement tuple. So things we could be measuring are things like the compile time, code size, the runtime is usually the one that people are interested in. That's often influenced by the code size. Optimal packing of, if I've got a tuple of char int char, do I want to reorder that to be a tuple of int char char as a storage, even though the interface exposes it in this sequence? That's certainly a much more interesting metaprogramming challenge. We've now got much more widespread conditional, the option to use no except much more widely than the standard mandates as the minimum level. I could put lots of conditional no except by saying, if all my operations are no except, then I'm no except as well. The standard chooses not to do this because it doesn't want to clutter our interfaces unduly. We put them where they're critical, but not necessarily where they're useful. Or different people have different notions of how useful these things are. I'm still talking to people who think they're going to see big benefits from the mechanical change of simply decorating these things with no except, as opposed to querying with a no except operator and radically changing the algorithms you're applying to code when you know no exceptions can propagate, you know, be thrown after a certain point. What we have no freedom for is to apply const expo where it's not mandated in the standard. Because that is observable as a change of behavior. It can be sphinoid and exposed. Whereas no except is exposed directly by the no except operator. So why we have prepared to do one but not the other, I never quite understood. But the consensus seemed to be that const expo, you're specifically not given freedom as a library vendor to put it where the library hasn't already put it. I have two hands. We'll start here.
What operations aren't const expo? You said constructors that take the user's allocator.
Okay. So the question is, which operations are not const expo? So the constructors that take allocators, swap and the assignment operators are also not const expo. I believe they could be. Be very unusual to have a const expo swap, but the notion is if I've got some code that's a const expo function, I can then manipulate things within that const expo function as long as the operations themselves are marked const expo, even if they're mutating operations. So the ability to have a const expo swap isn't as stupid as it sounds on the face of it. There was a hand over here and then...
Well, the second thing was, I'm just curious on your opinion. Do you think that it's a defect that no except is basically implementation defined if you can add
it? I really like having vendor freedom for... Oh, the question is, do I think it's a defect that vendors have the freedom to use no except where it might be beneficial but not mandated and therefore potentially produce incompatibilities? And certainly it's a vendor problem if they want to have different ABIs between successive releases of their library if they roll it out somewhere where it wasn't before. No, I think it's a great freedom. I really like vendors to have freedom to compete upon quality of implementation. And if somebody can get a real benefit from doing that, if we don't give them the chance to experiment and expose it, you know, we don't get to move forward or discover that was a blind end. And likewise, there's a suggestion, I think much more eager now on the library working group to grant similar freedom to const expo. Most people who are present now weren't people who were present when that decision was cast. So some of the more active people around now were only just coming on board around about then. So they seem much more gung-ho about vendor extensions to put const expo where they think it'll be helpful.
Yeah, I have the opposite opinion. I think they should be directly specified.
Well, I mean, part of that freedom is our freedom to extend it into the standard in the future. Otherwise, you're largely frozen by what the standard has today forevermore. And if there's real benefit in doing this, we want to have that freedom. There's a question down here.
Yeah, so what Louis actually discovered when he was implementing those tuple is that if you do your own layout, placement new is not const expo.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
That makes a problem for a conforming implementation because some of the constructors that should be const expo aren't.
No, it limits your implementation strategies. The point is, that was raised from Louis Dion when he was working, I believe, at the HANA tuple library, was that because placement new is not something that can be marked const expo, some of our implementation choices will turn out not to be available to us.
Question here.
There's another question I missed. Over here. Ah, so, and the point, the observation was for the same reason that the we can't do the placement new, we can't apparently use the lambda capture. Is that because lambda capture is not const expo before C++17, but will be in C++17?
Yeah.
So it's still viable as far as this talk's concerned. Although I didn't realize that was something I would have to bring into the talk, so thank you for bringing that one up. C++17, you can have const expo lambdas, the captures can be const expo, yes. So, back to our set of potential designs for a tuple. I'm ruling out the two with a question mark straight away, because I don't know of any compiler that's done the intrinsic thing, and I couldn't figure out how to do the lambda capture. I'll own up. So that it was all, I spent a while playing around with it and just couldn't figure out how to get the values through a lambda interface. So I'm going to have to think about that one some more. I like solving these puzzles rather than seeing the answer. So adaptive according to parameters, that was my goal, but I ran out of time to actually do enough different implementations, and in the end only had time for one implementation. So my comparisons that you'll have now between the existing standard libraries rather than between some of the strategies I was trying myself. Store elements in the managed char array was one I thought sounded a really fun, simple implementation, but as we mentioned, the const expr placement new means it could never be conforming. So I had to rule that one out. There was an awful lot of concern about doing, the question is, why don't we have const expr placement new? Const expr has always been an area of great caution by the compiler vendors, and anything that was trying to dereference a pointer in const expr was always going to be heading for trouble, even though all we're doing is passing an address here and saying, yeah, an address that we have to be able to pick up at const expr, we can get pointers at const expr, but we just can't use them. So, and I'm not sure if there's any proposals to revisit that at this point, but depending on whether or not their pointers into the same data structure, whether or not we can compare them for less than with const expr. If their pointers into different data structures, we should get a compiler error though, because undefined behavior is diagnosed at const expr. Although whether implementation defined behavior is allowed to define it in those contexts, I'm still not sure. Moving on, I'm left essentially with a recursive template implementation. Wow, that yellow and the green look very, very similar in color. That's going to mess up a bunch of my slides coming forward, I think. And, the multiple inheritance from the parameter pack expansion. And given I wanted to play heavily with fold expressions, I was picking the second one. Recursive templates, you end up writing the folds yourself with the template expansions rather than leaning on the new language features. You still do probably do a lot more folding traditionally with that than you would with the inheritance, but the folding techniques don't change. So again, one of the issues that's going to come out is we have the whole notion of compressed storage when I've got an empty base optimization. We want to take advantage of, if I've got an empty sub-object that's a base member, it's allowed to have the same address as other objects. This isn't allowed for a complete object. Otherwise, an array of these types would have length 0, and pointer arithmetic just wouldn't work well. So we inherit from C that we can't actually have zero size objects. But we do get the option to compress that storage away within our base objects, because we can guarantee within this data structure they're still going to have an object address different from other such empty objects. They just have to be the same as some other objects. Multiple indirect bases will still therefore have to have different addresses. The classic example, you can see I'm using a bind down here. I can have multiple ambiguous base classes essentially of the same kind. And each one of those would still have to have an incrementing address. So just because I'm using the empty base optimization, I can still generate tuples that are huge in size. A tuple of 1,024 empty objects is going to be size 1,024, not size 1, if I'm using the empty base optimization. But it's frequently helpful. The common case is people are thinking of the standard functors, allocators in the standard library. These are the kind of things that we routinely want to compress away. And if tuple does that, it's really nice to have that as a facility to build our larger data structures out of, even just as implementation detail. Probably mention what to say about that. Basic model of my tuple then is I want to have class template tuple that derives from a parameter pack as its base classes. Clearly that's not going to work when I've got a tuple event. Can't derive from primitive type. So we immediately wrap the type, so I'm going to have something that holds the int for me, which is great until I have a tuple of int and int, and now I've got two ambiguous base classes. I'm not allowed to have two direct base classes that are the same type. So we now need to have some way to index those classes so I can count them. And that then lets me solve the tuple of int and int problem. And we remember we were solving this problem with having to map indices to our types by using the C++ 14 index sequence feature. So the essence is I'm now going to have a base class that is going to have two parameter packs. A parameter pack, I spot a typo. That should be size T of indexes, not a type name of indices.
Index sequence four types.
No, the parameter type up here needs to be size T, dot, dot, dot. That's the typo on the slide, and the slide's not going to work if those are types and not size T's. And I'll talk through what size type index for types gives you shortly. So the idea is, assuming I've got a parameter pack of indices, I get an index sequence. An index sequence is an alias template for an integer sequence where the integer is type size T, so we just don't need to keep saying size T everywhere. This is the frequent use. It's for compile time indexing of things where operators give you size T's. So this index sequence, that's a pack of those indices. So those have to be size T or else that pack expansion is going to fail. So I've got a base class that's got its first parameter is going to be this empty index sequence type, followed by then by a pack expansion of types. This is a partial specialization. I've not shown you the primary template. The primary template would be base where type name index would be a type, not a pack expansion, because I'm going to drop in an index sequence for my partial specialization. The partial specialization is the key to what's happening here. Then I can now have got my two parameter packs. I can use a type I'm yet to write called wrap, and wrap index and types as a pack expansion, and that gives me as many base classes as I need of the appropriate type where I've counted each type that I'm storing the elements in. Implementation details to follow. You'll see a lot of implementation details to follow on the different slides. Okay, so tuple is now going to derive from that base type. Tuple couldn't itself do this trick because remember I said tuple only takes types. I have no place to partially specialize on this extra parameter pack of indices. I've got no way to produce them in tuple. So I have to go through a level of indirection, which is what my base class base is all about. Index for types is just a nice alias template in the standard that is index sequence of index, where index is size of types, dot, dot, dot. So I'm just throwing the vocabulary around. I could have actually done the size of dot, dot, dot types myself, but we have an alias there, we might as well use it. Nice thing about an alias is it's not a new class, it's just another name for an existing class. So we're not generating new names and symbols and bloat into the ABIs. So this is my tuple. I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to have it within my class for convenience. I'm going to name base. And then I can inherit all my constructors from base. And my plan is to put all the constructors for tuple, or as many as I can, into this base class, and then pull them out with inheriting constructors. Especially with the new C++ 17 inheriting constructors, that mean these aren't paying the overhead of an extra forwarding call. They really are just these constructors. Question at the back. I'm pretty sure I double-checked that in the standard before typing it, but my mind could easily have blanked and never got to copy-paste it. So for the camera, the question is, or the observation, this should be index sequence 4 rather than index 4 types. I've completely typoed the text I was trying to copy-paste from the standard. And even as I'm saying it, I'm convinced you're right. Thank you. Two typos on one slide. We're off to a good start. Now this is actual code that I've been compiling. Okay. So we're going to talk a little bit more about the compressed storage. The implementation we've seen, because we're using this inheritance trick, I've been told I've got 15 minutes left. There's no way I'm getting through this, however simple I think I've made the implementation, but hopefully I've front-loaded the interesting material. We're going to get this size thing for free. And I was making the observation here that size of tuple A is 1, size of tuple A and B is one. They're both empty types, and they will both occupy the same byte of same space within the object. Size of tuple of A and A, though, we're going to...
Are you sure? Because the type of wrap with a different index is different.
Yes, this is a good point. So the question is, am I sure that this is going to be size 2 and not 1? Yes, I am. Because that was my assumption. I thought, this has got to be size 1. Why are my objects larger than I expected? Always, when I've got repeated bases. The issue is, when I construct the wrapper for an empty base, I'm going to derive from that base class. That's how I make the base empty. So although my wrappers are all distinct, they all have the same empty base as their own base. So in the whole class graph, there are many copies of the same base class. One level up, when you're looking at the wrapper, the wrappers are distinct, but they in turn are deriving from the same empty class.
Yeah, maybe the member of maybe wrapper should just have a member of T, or not have a member.
If wrapper has a member of T, I've lost the empty base. It's a member and not a base class now.
You can have no member if the trait is empty comes in true.
There's a claim that I can have no member if the trait is empty comes in as true. I've lost my slide on that, but the fact that I don't have a valid object coming into existence to be casting means I'm violating a lot of the type-based aliasing rules and lifetime rules in the language. Well, the point is, when I'm trying to return the object, it has to be alive. I have to have a genuine object that has been constructed as that type in order to use it. And so if I'm trying to return, you know, get one and get two, and these things have to work. I can't keep, you know, destroying one to recreate the other. Or, okay, I don't need to destroy them. I can just recreate the other. But then the first one's no longer allowed to be referenced. There's a hand going up, but I want to move on quickly because times are running. So, and here's just a quick example of code that you can break the empty base class optimization with. I've got derived base, oops. So derived is my empty class. Base and derived base. Base is empty. I take a reference to base y. I call oops. Oops makes a brand new t and then overwrites it. So actually, although the object as an empty member has size, is occupying the same storage as another object, although I think all I see here is I've got a tref. I don't know that that empty object is part as an empty base class of a larger object. All I know is it's of size 1, and I can overwrite it with the copy of another one of these things. So I then overwrite part of the object that was occupying the same address as the original object. So if you're trying to play around with memcopy tricks and generic types, you probably want to do an extra specialization for the case that T turns out to be an empty type. Just flagging that up as we're going through. Doesn't actually affect my tuple implementation. It was something that ran through my head when I was looking at doing the array-based version. So, my empty wrapper that we were talking about earlier. Might be easier to talk about it with code on the screen. So, I'm having a general idiom for my types. I'm going to have two different types. One when I'm wrapping an object, and one when I'm deriving from a base, empty base class. And I'm going to have a similar interface. I'm going to have an element type T, sorry, an element type alias that I can use for some template metaprogramming tricks to pick out things like, you know, the tuple element for the whole tuple at the end. I've got an LM function to actually access the contents. So when I'm accessing a wrapper around an empty base class, I'm going to return star this. And likewise, I'm just going to inherit whatever constructors that empty type has. Just because it's empty doesn't mean it doesn't have interesting constructors. Question?
If T has a virtual function with
that, if T is virtual, it's not empty. If T is polymorphic, it's not empty by definition. Anything with a base class, with a V table, doesn't qualify. Then I'm going to have my stateful wrapper type. Doing something similar, I've got the same using, I've got the same access methods, but this time it's holding a T by value. Be really nice to just use this as an aggregate and go with it like that. I don't have my note as to why that didn't work.
We had problems though when I'm trying to initialize a tuple of int from a long. If I do that through aggregate initialization of value here, that's an error in conversion. We'll now fail to compile. But the tuple interface is supposed to take it. So I can't make this just a simple aggregate and use aggregate initialization to say I can initialize value however I could initialize value by passing it a brace list. I actually have to do the perfect forwarding constructor, which I believe I forgot to mark const expert. That's another bug. I'm then going to have an alias template to select which wrapper I get, which is conditional in this version as if T is an empty type, and it's not a final type, and it's not a union type, because those are distinct, I'll be derive element of type IT, otherwise I'll be wrap element of IT. So that alias template saves me writing another wrapper with its own extra symbols in the symbol table and everything else, neatly wraps through to when I now, you've seen this slide before, the code's the same, complete with all the typos. We now know what this wrap index type is. I've still got to provide all the constructors that delegate down. But I'm going to have to pass on questions. I'm really low on time now. And I do want to at least get some of the more interesting slides up. Basic tuple API of get is fairly simple. There's many overloads depending on CV ref qualification of your elements. But we've got two interfaces. I can go for size T, for I, get me the element at index I. Or for type T, get me the element that corresponds to that index. And I've got this meta function that tells me what I get if I go by index, and it just really is the reference to whatever I ask for with the same CV qualification otherwise. This is a really simple implementation with this parameter pack base class. Basically, get is going to call getImple with an index of me, basically. And then I will slice to the appropriate base class. So it's like, okay, I know I'm type I, and I can deduce T. So I don't even need to tell you what type T is going to be. And it's already coded into the base class. Get is just sliced to that base and return the element it contains, which is handy that both the derive and the wrap type have the same interface to do that. So slicing to get by index is really simple. And just as simple to go by type. You just change the order of the two parameters, you're done. So that's get solved very quickly. Implementing comparison operators. We've got the six logical comparison operators, which is where I'm going to get to the big bug I did spot before I came out here. As long as each function supports the appropriate comparison. Only operators less than and equal are required. Everything else is synthesized out of those two. So my basic implementation is a const expert function. I can compare tuples of different types. It's a heterogeneous operation, but they have to be the same length. So I'm going to delegate to my implementation namespace r equal function my two tuples and an index sequence for, I got the name right this time, index sequence for the first pack. Doesn't matter that we know the packs are the same size because otherwise this doesn't work. Of course, we could simplify, this is my extension that I still keep trying to propose to WG21, it hasn't got there yet. When I was measuring it, it actually produced slightly smaller symbol tables, so I kind of like it. Rather than having tuples here, I could just have T and U, and then make index sequence for the tuple size of the first one, as long as T and U support the tuple interface. So if I can do tuple size and tuple element on these, I know they behave sufficiently like a tuple, I'll be able to use them in operator equal equal. Then things get a bit messy. We've still yet to see the actual implementation of R equal. R equal is fairly simple, but this thing is what the heck. This is our enable if to make sure that the packs are of the same length. But when I used enable if, Clang helpfully told me I couldn't use enable if to constrain in this context. And I've not yet had time to figure out what the constraint that I was running into was. I'm going to have to pass on the question, sorry, because I really don't have time. here's what I've got. So sorry, that's why I couldn't use enable if. Then why am I using this function? Why basically I'm constructing a tuple size t object and then multiplying them for some reason. Why aren't I using, whoops, wrong way, our wonderful underscore v variable templates I told us we were going to play so much with. Turns out you get non-sphenoiable errors if you use those in that context. If I do tuple int 2 is equal to 1, that's clearly not going to compile. But I want that hit to hit my sphenoi condition and be passed over looking for something else. I don't want that to be a hard error. Because this could be any picked up by any overload set saying, what equals can I find? Oh, I found one here. Boom, bang. That's not good. So it turns out that forcing the early evaluation with the variable template was giving me an error. Whereas when I went with tuple size, and I've got an extension that my tuple size implementation, if you're not a tuple, is empty. So my tuple size is sphenoi friendly. Again, I thought I had got an earlier slide on that. I must have cut it in the final reckoning. Means that this will only be evaluated if those objects and to get to the point they can construct. So I've then gone with using make a pointer to an array of size either 0 or 1, depending upon whether both bools are tuple size. Oh yeah, whether they're whether tuple size is empty or not. Okay, I'm going to run overthinking myself here, but that's the syntax that worked. So we then get to actually perform the comparison, which is the whole reason we're trying to do all this. This is where the fold expressions come to play. So I've now got, pulled my index sequence out, so I've now got my two types and a pack of indices that's exactly as large as the tuple size of both A and B. So I can now perform a fold expression where I do get index of A is equal to get index of B. And the nice thing here is the only parameter pack I'm expanding is index. I'm not having to do anything funky with parameter of pack of T types and U types and potentially trying to unpack multiple packs within the fold expression. I'm back down to a single fold expression, single pack to do the fold expression on. And if the size is 0, it always returns true. That's the default. And I claimed it was just as easy to do less. I was wrong. So that's my homework that I spotted half an hour before coming out to the talk today. I went, ah! So much of my, let's move on, I don't have time to talk about it, sorry. Swap, again, very similar. This time I'm using the comma operator to do the swap. And again, even though it's a standalone swap, it's still got to be in the parentheses. We also get to use, because swap is required to have the right exception specification, I get to use the fold expression in my no except specification, which you will notice means I have to double up the parentheses, one for the no except and then one for the fold expression. Otherwise, I think that's fairly straightforward. I said, I have to run really fast now, so. Default constructor, can we use the implicit default for our constructor? So tuple int of x just works, and I don't actually have to write constructors. That'd be fantastic. It's also not going to work, because I expect tuple int of const y to also initialize and not say, no, you've not initialized your object, which is why I'm saying I don't think trivial types actually can work here. And likewise, if I do get 0, I expect the value 0 to come out, not to be undefined behavior. So I can't rely on the implicit default. So I'm going to have to write it. And if I've got a wonderful type like no default, just do my pack expansion to say value initialize everything means I've got a non-template function here that it's very easy to trigger a hard compiler error here because this is not deleted, it's not missing, it's present but doesn't compile. If any element in my types is a type that doesn't have a default constructor. So I'm going to have to find a way to sphenoi out this non-template constructor in those circumstances. I'm doomed. I can't do that. Well, I'm going to fake it, but concepts will let me do that directly. This is where we're really missing concepts. The fake is we turn it into a template. And then we're doing this funky trick again with a pointer to an array of, I'm now going to use the multiply fold expression on a Boolean type. So if all those Boolean types are true, I'm multiplying 1 by 1 by 1 by 1 by 1 by 1, and it's valid, yes. If any of them is false, I've got a 0 in the multiplication, and the fold says, no, it's false. You've got a size 0 array, and that's going to spin out. This is horrible, but it works. This is what I was saying about simple, keeping everything constrained. I'm using the minimal of delegation to write other funky template metaprograms. Everything's there. And?
Yeah, an and fold expression.
Maybe, I mean, because this is going to be an array, I wanted to make clear I was getting a number out. But. Ah. I went with multiply roll and entry. Maybe it was just to show off an extra bullet, but it's also one letter smaller. These are long names. I'm really trying to fit them on the page. Implicit copy move constructors. Okay, so I had to define the default. Can I get the default constructor? Can I get away with implicit copy and move constructors? Because if I don't define them, fewer chances to introduce bugs in components that are really easy to make bugs on, fewer opportunities to screw performance up, and I will get correct const expert and exception specifications for free. So the wrap class actually does work perfectly this way. So my wrap class does not declare and define, it takes the implicit copy constructor and move constructor. I've not yet figured out why that didn't work when tuple inherited all the constructors from that base class. But what I was getting when I was using a tuple of a move-only type, and I constructed by an R value of a move-only type, it was complaining that it couldn't compile the copy constructor. Don't know why. That was the fix. So I explicitly default them rather than implicitly default them, and everything just works. But it's better to, it would be nice to understand why I have to do this. I don't understand whether it was a compiler bug, because, you know, lots of interesting things happening around my implementation, but that was, where am I on time? I've got 3 minutes left, it seems. Negative minutes. My clock is lying to me then. Okay, no, he's telling me the truth, I'm just misreading it. Sorry folks, I'm happy to keep presenting slides into the break, but I guess some folks will want to go out and somebody else is going to come and steal the podium away from me. So I'll take a bow and then keep going. I try to think if there's anything that I can pick out particularly quickly. I'll probably just jump to the numbers I got out at the end, just some comparison between the different implementations. Compared with the GCC standard library, the Clang standard library, and my homebrew library, the maximum length for a tuple varied, because a lot of these operations start, even though I think all three of them are using the variadic base class approach, some of the computations of metaprogram they're doing, I think, are using an awful lot of the conjunction-disjunction type logic that turns into a very recursive step. So you quickly hit the recursive instantiation limits of the compiler. So it turned out Clang struggled at 125, and actually less if you wanted to use do equal or anything, because that used up another level of your recursion. GCC seemed to be fairly good, up to about 512. I didn't take mine past 1,023. 1,024 is the maximum size guaranteed in the language for a parameter pack and the number of base classes and so forth. So I didn't want to go busting other language limits. Build time. GCC didn't cope with my program at all. I then tried it on my test program. So I didn't have my library in there at all, just the GCC tuple. And it still failed to build my test driver, which I found quite surprising. And again, it was hitting resource limits. So my earlier test of a 512 must have been using different operations. Something in the larger test driver is now exercising something where GCC can't recurse to even 123 was the number of elements I had in my largest tuples. Build time. Likewise, Clang was about 8 seconds. My homebrew was about 2.4. So doing everything with fold expressions everywhere gave me fairly good build times.
because the result I was hoping for was looking for this to be a simple implementation that should appeal well to compilers. I was less happy when I looked at task size. Looking at those task sizes, I can see that I've put something in the wrong boxes. The best case scenario is they're just upside down for the default, but those numbers are wrong. The Clang was definitely much smaller than mine on the executable image. And when I went to optimize code, it was much more pronounced. That Clang went from being, assume Clang was 80,000 down to 4,000. I'm still running around about 18K for a program that was essentially moving empty types around. So clearly the Clang optimizer is doing a much better job. Their library is killing a lot of redundant symbols. I'm not sure why I'm introducing them, but they're paying for it in build time, which is what I was saying up front. There's, you can optimize around a bunch of different things. Seems that my attempt to go simple has also optimized around build time. At the expense of my optimization, I was expecting to see things from the inheriting constructors would have given me smaller image sizes, and that didn't turn out to be the case. The code for this will hopefully be online in around a month. I need some time to clean it up, but I've also got a standards meeting to prepare for, and there's a mailing deadline coming up, so I'm not going to get anything done on this in the next 3 weeks. But hopefully after that, I'll be getting this code cleaned up, and I'll be pushing it up on GitHub, and I'll talk to John Kalb to find the best place to advertise it so everyone around here knows where to get hold of it. Thank you.